Well, good evening and welcome everyone to the new Hangout, the first Hangout for the 2014-15 season. We are almost back with the VELUX EHF Champions League, and that means, of course, we are back with our VELUX EHF Champions League Hangouts. Well, a new season brings old faces, brings new faces, but first of all, I want to welcome a new face to our round, and Katharina Heder, who runs the handball blog Handball 2.0 in Germany, has just confessed before we started that she watched every Hangout since there have been Hangouts. And so, well, we couldn't resist inviting her. Well, welcome, Katharina. How are you?
Hi there. I'm a bit nervous, but almost quite interested in the today's topics.
Well, the topics, I can assure you, it's a lot about the VELUX EHF Champions League and me. Probably everything will be about the VELUX EHF Champions League. And, well, the three guys who can tell us quite a bit about this is, well, our EHF TV commentator, Tom, who joins us again from Ireland, as per usual. Hi, Tom.
Hi, Thomas, Bjorn, Goran, Katharina, welcome.
Hi.
Hi, Tom.
Thanks for introducing our two other faces today. Our EHF journalist, Bjorn Patzen, who joins us, well, from his almost empty home, as he is just about to move into a new place. Hi, Bjorn.
Hi, Thomas. Hi, everybody.
And last but not least, Goran Antevski, our expert for everything that's happened in Macedonia. Hi, Goran. How are you?
Nice to see you again. I hope this will be also a very good season for teams from Macedonia, and see you in Cologne.
Well, I think we'll come back to Cologne at the end of this Hangout. But Tom, first of all, we're just about 24 hours away from the first game. If you had to sum up the upcoming season with, you know, just a few keywords, what do you think fans and the Handball Europe is in for?
My word would be lottery, Thomas. Lottery. For the first time, I think that we can safely say that there are more than 6 to 7 teams that could make the Final Four in Cologne.
Bjorn, like I give this question straight to the floor. What is your key word for this season, Bjorn?
To be honest, to use this famous EHF branding word, I would say it would be an electrifying season. With, as Tom mentioned, I even say it can be about 9 teams which can hope to go to Cologne.
9 teams, Goran. Can you top 9, or is it going to be Vardar or Metalurg for the first time, and just another 3 that you name?
Vardar, Metalurg, and 2 more teams that will be perfect for us. But I think that this will be very exciting season, because as from my point of view, at least 7 or 8 teams have a quality to qualify for the Final Four. So in each group will be very interesting to see who will be on the first 4 places. So I will see. I will tell you that this will be very excited.
Katharina, how do you see the upcoming season, and how many teams would you name that can potentially make it to Cologne?
I think it's, in one word, it's a special season. So on the one hand, we've got the last season with this modest and EHF Champions League. On the other hand, we've got many teams who were supposed to made it to Cologne. I think, well, a number... It's hard to say, because the question is what will happen after the group phase. So the first thing is who wins his group, and who might have some weaker opponents. So this is the first question. I think, yeah, 6 to 16, Tom, well, a bit high, but I think around 10 should be possible to make it to Cologne. They have a good team and some kind of a special team spirit, and the last year's season showed us how special EHF Champions League works and could be. No one thought Hamburg will lose against one of the Skopje teams. So, special season this year.
Well, before we go into more details for, you know, like the favorites, the outside favorites to make it to Cologne, I just want to invite all fans following us here, send us your questions on Twitter at EHFCL, and if possible, we'll throw them in and give them to our experts for them to answer. Well, I think it's apt to start with the defending champions. Björn, you saw them in Qatar, where they lost the semi-final at the Super Globe. How's Flensburg doing from your point of view at the moment?
And what I would say the interesting fact is that the team is quite new. They have a lot of young players to get integrated. Lubomir Franjes is an expert in integrating young players. When you see the last 10 minutes in the normal time in the semi-final in Cologne against Barcelona, when all the young boys were on the field. So I would say it's hard to replace a player like Knudsen, especially in defense. But I think the time will tell that they definitely go to the knockout stage in this season. But I don't think that they have the power in the group stage to be ahead of Barcelona. But as we will see, is that the later the season goes, the better Flensburg gets. Because I think if this new young team gets balanced and gets rehearsed, they might have a good chance. So, of course, among those nine teams I mentioned is Flensburg also, but they are not on the number one position to be definitely in Cologne. But I think as they arrived this year in Cologne as the underdogs, they would like to take this role again.
Tom, how do you see Flensburg?
Yeah, I'm more or less exactly the same as Bjorn said. I think Knudsen's a big miss for them. They've bought Zaki Arison. I'll eventually learn how to pronounce his name, Thomas, I'm sure. And they brought the boy from Aalborg, Johan Jakobsen. And is he as good as Weinhold? Don't think so. But Bjorn will be able to tell us. I think Kaufman seems to be back, seems to be training. And I think he won Player of the Month for them in August. You don't know whether that's a sympathy vote, you know, from the fans. They're just so happy to see him back. But you can't see it when you see the strengthening that other teams have done over the summer. You can't see Flensburg being a major force this year again.
You're talking about...
By the way, Thomas, just plus also, the surprise is no longer there.
Yeah. You were just mentioning transfers. And so for you guys, who's made the biggest signings, the most important transfers for the upcoming season?
Especially PSG, I think. Meanwhile, the Flensburg transfers, I just saw them a lot of times in the preparation playing, and I think it's the same as last year. Just give them time. I think they played as well as last year now, but I think they will play better. Give them time almost around November, I think, you will be surprised what Flensburg is able to do. Meanwhile, I think Paris did the most interesting transfer and maybe the best ones, because I think Thierry Omeyer is a very hard transfer for them, and it's important to get some kind of a team. This was the most big point. I think, Tom, you mentioned it last year that Paris missed.
I think she's right, Thomas. I put a list together. I'd like to hear what the other guys have to say. I put a list together of the top four teams in terms of transfers, and I put Paris Saint-Germain as number one, because their big problem last year was exactly what Katrina said, no team, and now they've got a very French backbone, and Omeyer in goal is definitely better than what they had last year with Sierra. In second place, I put West Brom. I think Margucci is a fantastic signing from the right wing. Mickler in goal is absolutely sensational. And Seitz, well, you just never know what he's going to do. And Nodge can't play every single second of every game, and they've had a real problem there. I still think they've no backup for Illich, but those three signings are great. Then you look at Kiel, and you look at Weinhold. I think he's a very, very good player. He's a great replacement for Seitz. I think Canellas is a fantastic centre player. I think we're only going to see him get better. And if we think of when they signed Vuyin a couple of years ago, he didn't fit in with their style of play. I think Duvniaka will take time, but looks like he should be a fantastic signing. And in fourth place, believe it or not, I put Barcelona, just because I think that their left wing problem is going to be solved with Sigurdsson. I don't think that they had a great left wing last. I mean, we had Garcia, but I think that they had some problems after that. Maybe his legs had gone. I think Sigurdsson's is a fantastic signing. Their big problem is going to be in goal. They brought the young Vargas guy back to Barcelona, but he's still only young. So they're my four teams in terms of transfers who I think have done the best business this summer.
Goran, how do you see the transfers, especially looking at Paris, where Tom will be in just about 5 days, is that correct, on Saturday or Sunday for Match of the Week?
I'll be down there with Goran, eating his mother's ivor, apparently.
Yes. Well, so in terms of the transfers, I think Tom already said everything, which is important. But I think that for me also, the main transfers made Paris Saint-Germain Vardar, they signed with two great goalkeepers. And I think that those two goalkeepers will give a big strength to the teams. And I think that we'll have to wait at least 1 month, maybe two or three rounds, to see which team is in good shape or not. Because last season we also have to say that Paris Saint-Germain is one of the favorites, also Hamburg, but they didn't go to the quarterfinal, not to go to the Final Four. So I think also we will need a little time to see which team made a good job during the summer, because you have to sign for very good players, but maybe you will need time to get integrated to the teams. Depends from the their performance in the moment, but I think that in the beginning of November we will have a group of 4 or 5 teams which are really favorites for the Final Four. In terms of Paris Saint-Germain and Metalurg, I think that will be very interesting to see the new strength of Metalurg. So I will like to see his comments about the new team from Skopje.
What is the new strength of Metalurg from your point?
Lino Červar decided to make some changes in the team. He kept the old guys, I mean old who play in the team for 5-6 years, and he also signed several very talented guys from the neighbor countries, for example Lipovina, Borazan, Cindric, Djukic. They're very talented, and I think that in the next 2 or 3 years, also Marcinic from Partizan, they have very young, not so experienced teams, but with a lot of fighting spirits. So I think that this fighting spirits will be a new strength for Metalurg. For me, it's also interesting to see how will be the mix of old and new guys. Also, this season we will see Naucha Mojsovski, who is back on the back position after his injury. Vugrinets is old, but is not so old to forget to play handball. I think that will be a new guys from Metalurg who will show their strength, and they will be a new stars in the team.
Tom, just because he asked you, maybe you can quickly give us your opinion on Match of the Week, the new strength of Metalurg, and very quickly in one word, because we've got a question here coming in, probably from Italy, judging by the name, Rodrigo Figliolini. Tom, do you think Rhein-Neckar-Löwen can make it to the Final Four this season? Just very briefly.
Well, I'd let Bjorn take that question instead, because he will have seen all the new signings they've made, and they've made a few changes there. So I'd let him take it. But based on what they did last year, I can't see them not being one of the teams that we spoke about at the start that have a great chance. Yeah, Goran is absolutely right. I still think that Lino Červar will go with his old guys when it comes to the Champions League. I think he's been allowing these young boys to play in the Seha League. They got an absolute hiding over in West Brom there just recently, lost by about 12 goals. And I just think that when it comes to the Champions League, he has a certain style he likes to play. The young guys, it'll take them a while to learn that, because young guys like to run around a lot. But I do think that he will play Marcinic on the line. He looks like a real talent, this boy from Partizan that they're after bringing in. Wears number 33 for anybody who's going to be watching on Sunday, match of the week over in Skopje. And he looks like a big, serious lad, a big unit in there in the line, Thomas. Strong, good defensively as well, which will allow him to be able to make the change with Janowski and Markowski at the back as well. On the right wing, I think we will see Lipovina play, although I fancy him to start with Mirkolovsky in the right back position, Goran, just because he knows the Champions League. And as we all know, we'll be missing Renato on Sunday. He's not able to play because he was a little bit of a bold boy in the Kiel game, and he said something nasty to the referees.
But indeed, Tom, one has to say, if you predict that Rijnacka Leuven would have a hard way, maybe we have another German team which wins the Champions League, reminding what you said about Flensburg-Handewitt last year.
Yeah, well, I mean, I did say they'd get to the Final Four. I just didn't think they'd win it, but there you go. I didn't think Hamburg would win it the week, year before either. But I'd like to hear what Bjorn has to say about Rijnacka Leuven, Thomas, because there's been a few changes over there, you know. Brought in a few changes as well.
Go ahead, Bjorn.
It all depends on how everything around the club affects the players and the team and everything like this. You know, the manager, Thorsten Sturm, left to THW Kiel. The press officer left to THW Kiel. Some players left. The new coach, they have to integrate. But I think that Jakobsen is favorite to bring young players up, what he also did in Aalborg. And for me, I really like this player, is how to see Mats Mensah Larsen this year. And to see, of course, some other players like Reinkind or younger players they have signed at the Leuven squad now. And we have to see, it's the last year of Mürhol and Landin and Leuven. And if you know both, they will give 100% until the very last shot of the season. So I would say, of course, they belong to these 10 potential teams that go to Cologne. They're not number one or number two. But it will be interesting to see how they will work. And especially when you see Oliver Rogic, who was nearly not playing last season anymore, is now the assistant, especially the defense coach. You know what the instructions of Rogic will be, to count on a strong defense. And then you have young, talented players which were signed by Leuven now. So I think it will be interesting. Of course, they got a really interesting, nice group with all these top teams like Montpellier, like West Brom, and like WADA. So it will be very interesting how they cope with the situation of the top matches in this group, and how those young players get integrated. And one player, everybody talks about the players in attack who left the Leuven, but I think one very important player who left them was Manojlovic for the defense. And then we're back for all the transfers Tom mentioned. And in case we put at this list with one more club, then look at Meshkov Press, because they made very interesting signings during the last season and the beginning of this season, including this defense backbone of Nikola Manojlovic. So it will be interesting to see how they work. But my opinion, Leuven can make it definitely to the knockout stage. And then everybody knows it all depends on the position after the group phase and then on the draws you will have. Last year they beat Kielce and they nearly beat Barcelona. So just wait and see what will happen this season.
Well, Rodrigo, I think we can give you some hope. You know, our experts see them on Monday. 5, 6, 7 teams, 8 teams.
Thomas, look, Rodrigo from Italy needn't be worried. You know, with that Italian team getting knocked out in the qualifying group. Rijnacka Leuven will qualify from Group C. What's interesting about Group C is that two big names of European Champions League handball will be gone after the group phase, and that's what's interesting. That's a really tough group.
So, well, name them. Who do you think is going to be the two?
Well, I'm saying Montpellier and Tchaikovsky will be the two teams that will be gone after the first round. Dragan Gajic, I'm sorry if you're listening, and Vid Kaptichnik down there, my two Twitter buddies down there, Montpellier, I'm really sorry, but I don't think they'll make it.
Would you guys agree? Is Group C definitely the toughest
Let me change my thing there. Celje made a lot of changes as well, but they're kind of a weird team, Celje, aren't they? When they get to the Champions League, they have a little bit of something going on. Could be Celje or Montpellier for fourth place.
Would you agree?
I'm putting on my sunglasses.
Yeah.
And I'm saying.
would you guys agree? Is Group C definitely the closest of all, the closest to call of all four groups?
No, I didn't think. I think we've got two tough groups. It's B and C. So you shouldn't underline, you shouldn't forget that Flensburg play in a very hard group. So there are four hard teams fighting each other for the victory of the group phase. And then we've got two other teams where nobody knows exactly what they are able to do. So, for example, I myself did not think Besiktas Istanbul will make it to the group phase, and they are there. So I think it's quite interesting thinking back to Foxes Berlin. They made it until the Final Four in Cologne, and nobody thought they were able to do this. So I think it would be quite interesting to see what happens in Group B either to Group C. But indeed, Tom is right when he said Montpellier is another kind than Besiktas Istanbul. So it's a very tough game, and they had some very tough losses. So besides Thierry Omeyer, it's almost William Accombray and the brothers Karabatic were lost last year. So one has to see what they are able to do.
Qualified for the World Championship, and the Slovenian national team nearly is not here. And so I expect them better than the Slovenia 2 in Celje.
Yeah, but they might end up, you know, waving that flag when they go over there, you know. But listen, Bjorn, I think it's interesting. Group C, what I'm saying here is that two teams with a tradition in the VELUX EHF Champions League will be gone after the first phase, right? In Group B, I think. Assuming that Manolo Cadenas knows what he's doing in Plotsk, I imagine them to be the fourth place team there. Group D is the most open, apart from Kielce. I don't think anybody really knows what the other teams will achieve. And in Group A, you've got three very strong teams. I, again, Goran, think that Metalurg will make it in Group A. And then you've got Zagreb, Naturhaus, and Brest. We don't know who can come fourth there. We won't know for about 2 or 3 weeks to see exactly. I'm just saying Group C is the toughest group in terms of the two big names that historically, and in fact, Montpellier and Celje both have won the Champions League, and one of them could be gone after the first group, which is unheard of, really, when you think about it.
All right. Agreement all around. Bjorn,
silence all around, Thomas. That's what it was.
Bjorn, can I throw this? Katarina mentioned Besiktas, and I know you did a bit of preview work for us around Besiktas Istanbul. They are the only complete newbie to the Champions League. They've never played the group phase before, but they vowed, and I like that comment. They vowed that they're going to fight until they're, you know, even their socks are torn apart. So what can we expect of Besiktas from your point of view?
I would say the hopes are very high. And when you read in the preview, when you read that the manager, that the coach is saying that it will take some years until Besiktas is one of the teams going to Cologne, they're very confident in Istanbul, I think. And of course, they signed a player like Ivan Ninčević, who's an experienced player international. And they have a very strong shooter in Ramazan Döner. And you never know. But I really think the problem of them will be the lack of international experience, which you already saw 2 years ago when they were playing in the EHF Cup. But yes, they have nothing to lose. They can come if nobody expects so much from them, maybe outside of Istanbul. But so they're known to be a strong home team, and I don't think that they can take so many points in away matches. But it's always interesting when you have a new country and a new club in the Champions League, and so. As I said, they have nothing to lose, so let's wait and see what they're doing.
Thomas, I think what Bjorn said there is very, very interesting, right? Because what we have here is we've got a team that has no experience whatsoever in the Champions League. And if you look at Dunkirk last season, if you look at Naturhaus La Rioja and these kind of guys, they were overwhelmed for the first 5 or 6 weeks. I mean, it's not just getting out on the court and playing. It's the fact that the cameras are there, EHF TV is there, the floor is there, the marketing supervisor are there, the referees, delegates, everybody. You know, the big spotlight on you when you're playing the Champions League. It's not just like playing any other home game or any other EHF Cup game. That's no offense to the EHF Cup. So the fact of the matter is, if you haven't played it before, or you're not at that level at the moment, you know what I mean? It takes a few years to get there. I think we'll see with Dunkirk this year that they will perform better because it's not such a huge thing. Maybe Naturhaus La Rioja might perform better, and they did quite well last year, and I think Aalborg make it? They did make it to the last 16 last year, so they also have a chance. But I think for the likes of Alingsås and Besiktas, and maybe even Brest, even though apparently Brest is a very difficult place to go, first year in there doing it, not so easy. Am I right, Bjorn? It's a big deal.
Yeah. Well,
I wanted to say something.
Yeah, I've got a completely other point of view. Maybe it's the wonder of Berlin reminding me to fix a Berlin. They have the same story. They've got no experience in EHF Champions League. I think once they played their second or third season in German Bundesliga. So I think Ivan Ninchevich, who talked with Handballwoche, is right when he said we've got nothing to lose. So I think it's more the point of view that they have no pressure, because everybody, and maybe themselves either, would say that they get out in the first round. So I think it's not that unimportant for them to make a good play. So in this case, I think maybe this could be a thing for the mind. So, well, they must play a good handball, that's outstanding, but meanwhile, yeah, playing a good handball...
If we think about Berlin back in those days, Bjorn, remember, they'd signed Igropolo, who played with Barcelona, they'd signed...
The first season with EHF Champions League, there was no Igropolo.
The one where they got to the Final Four. They had all these great players. They had Torsten Lane, they had Igropolo, they had you know, Besiktas have signed Ivan Ninchevich. I mean, he's a good player, and he was actually on the Fuchs Berlin team. But when we're talking about Ivan Ninchevich as being your star signing, Bjorn, am I right? We're not talking about a team that's thinking big.
This is exactly what I wanted to say, Katarina, that the base from which Füchse Berlin started their first experience in the Champions League was a quite different base to what Besiktas is doing now.
Yeah, but I got your point, but I think it's almost a question of what mind is in your head when you're going out. If you go out and play handball and have fun, it's might a factor that makes you much more or that brings you in a mood that you think you can reach everything. And I think this could be a factor that they are able to beat some nice teams in Group B. So I got your point, but indeed, one has to say they had broken
cover. I think time will tell, probably.
The only way Besiktas is going to do anything against FC Barcelona, SG Flensburg Handewitt, Kifkold in Copenhagen, is if Walt Disney himself comes down to Istanbul and creates an entire fairyland of handball, you know, where the other guys are cartoon characters. There's just no way Besiktas are going to perform against these teams.
So we'll wait until either Walt Disney comes out, comes down to Istanbul, or until the group phase has been played. Guys, can I throw in another question, which brings us back to Match of the Week and Paris Saint-Germain, a question we got here on Twitter from Strax Spiller. Many of you will probably know him. He runs a handball blog himself. And he asks, or he says, that no doubt PSG has the talent on court, but how does the coach compare to Gislason, Dushebaev, and Pascual?
It's a very interesting thing that if you extend the contract with your coach, but despite this extended contract, you start negotiations with the other coach, in this case, first with Valero Rivera and then with Lubomir Franjes. It says a little bit about the mentality of the club. If you have either you extend the contract with the coach and you persuaded that Philippe Gardin will make it with you to all the goals you have, becoming French champion, making it to Cologne, but then you cannot extend the contract and then negotiate with other coaches. So this is only the open question. A lot of media all over Europe says, how long will Philippe Gadart stay the coach? And the only answer of this is they were looking for other coaches, but none of them wanted to go to PSG.
What's your ranking of you, of these coaches, Goran? How do you see that question?
I think that the weakest place in the Paris Saint-Germain team is the coach. I agree with Bjorn. It's very interesting to see that the club is looking for a new coach and they already extended the contract. So I think is until this coach is with Paris Saint-Germain, they will have a lot of problems against almost every team, and maybe they need a stronger coach with stronger hands, because they have a lot of stars, and if you have a lot of stars in the team, it's very hard to put everything on site to prepare some good picture. I think that Paris Saint-Germain will also have a lot of problems in Skopje, but this year I'm not sure that Metalurg will win so easy like last season. And even I'm from Skopje, I could not prediction the result, because the both teams have a lot of their own problems. But definitely the coach position in Paris Saint-Germain is the weakest position, I think, in the French team. With this coach, we can expect that Paris Saint-Germain will also lose in Skopje. But in Metalurg also has a lot of changes, so will be very hard to predict the results from Sunday.
Tom, do you think it could work in Gadart's favor that Paris signed this French trio, Omallier, Akombe, Barachet, and do you think he will field them all straight away?
Well, it'll suit him because they all speak the same language as him, Thomas. I mean, I think God help Philippe Gandon. And to be honest, Thomas, I really don't want to comment on the coach who's in place and who's doing the job as best he can. It cannot be easy to have what I consider to be so many egos on the one team, so many stars, because it's difficult to please everybody. One of the things he has done well at the start of the season is he started to use Gabor Chassard again, who did very well in the Trophée des Champions, where they won, and he played quite a substantial part there. I think that Barachet is an interesting addition to the team. He's a young French player, and he's always done well with young French players. Problem, of course, with Barachet at the moment is he's got a broken finger and he won't be playing for a couple of months. So it's difficult. It's difficult to know what to say. I mean, when you have a team like this, if you can, I don't think his role is to be so much a coach as to be a sort of a man who puts the best seven out at any one time, and he keeps them with a good mentality. You know, if he can get them to play for each other, if that's all, because really with that kind of star-studded super lineup, what are they going to do any differently to anybody else, Thomas? Not that much, you know what I mean? And I think Gardon's biggest thing is to keep people happy, that there is not discontent within the ranks. And I think that now that they're another year in Paris, that players who've come from, say, Croatia, who are now living in Paris, they're probably more used to the way of life. The French players, of course, will know Paris or will know France and know the way things work. They have much more a French spine now than they had before, and I think that that can only help. And I think that for Gardon, it must be very difficult if always in the news is they're looking for Dujubayev to take over your job, they're looking for Valero Rivera to take over your job, and then they're looking for Lyubomir Vranjes, and Lyubomir Vranjes turns down the job and says, yeah, I don't want a budget of 15 million, I'm living my dream in Flensburg. I mean, what's the poor guy? I mean, it can't be easy waking up. And then, of course, they lose last week's game away from home, which I think gives Metalurg a bit of a chance this weekend, because it seems that they haven't quite got that away team performance quite right, even though everything is perfect. They fly in charter jet, they fly out straight after the game, there's no wasting time, there's no getting coaches for 26 hours like Chiesa did when Bogdan Venta was in charge. I mean, these guys have got everything on a silver platter for them, so we should really see a much, much better PSG. By the way, at the draw, Bruno Martini said, you know, we've become a little bit more modest. We're not sort of out there blowing the trumpet saying, look, we're Paris Saint-Germain. And I really hope to see that this year from them, you know, that they're more helpful, that they're more open to all of us in the media and so on and so forth.
Guys, I'm afraid to say we already talked for more than half an hour, and I'm not going to cut it short right now, because I think there's still a few more topics we can briefly touch on. We haven't mentioned the second VELUX EHF Final Four participant from this year, THW Kiel. Maybe I'll ask our two Germans, Katharina and Björn, to briefly comment on THW Kiel and their performance so far and how far they can go. Obviously, big signings for the backcourt line with Weinhold, with Kaneas, Duvniak. Too many signings, or too many cooks, as they say in English, that spoil the broth. Katharina, how do you see it?
Well, I think they got a similar problem to Paris, but they have a better solution than Paris. So they signed very good players, and maybe the best at the moment in Germany. So Weinhold is a great player. Kaneas and Duvniak either. So they profited of HSV Hamburg's situation the most. So they signed them for rather less money. So I think they mustn't paid any money for Kaneas, so that's a good deal, I think. Meanwhile, this problem must be solved in the last week by Gislason. They have trained a lot, I think on Sunday about 5 hours, so very hard job on a Sunday, I think. So I think we will know more after tomorrow's game in German Bundesliga. By now I think they will play every third day, and they will make it to Cologne. If they won't, I won't be in their cabin when Alfred joins.
Yeah, and is it just a matter of time until everyone has adopted to the Kiel system?
Yeah, you just have to see what the problem of Kiel is. Usually in the last season they scored 33, 34 goals in average. This season it's something about 24, 25. I think if their attack fits well, because all of the options they have in the backcourt line. What we should not forget is what also Tom mentioned for his transfers is, in my opinion, they lost a very important player for them in Gudjon Valur Sigurdsson as a left wing player. He was he scored nearly 95% of all counterattack goals, and hopefully Dominik Klein can fit this role. But to be honest, in compared what Katharina said to PSG, of course they have a bunch of stars there. But who knows, Alfred Gislason? He will keep them quite short, and he will integrate them all when you see what he did in half a year with Wien in his first season. So definitely Kiel, in my opinion, they go to Cologne, and they will be stronger than ever maybe in Cologne. But yes, it is depending on the final position of the group phase. If they finish on the first position, then they have an easy way maybe to Cologne. If they finish below PSG, what I don't expect is that it can be 50-50 match in the quarterfinals.
Mm. Strong.
Yep,
strong.
But indeed.
Yep, quickly.
Just saying, Dominik Klein does a good job. First thing, meanwhile, not as goggy, but almost a good job. And second one was the results in German Bundesliga this season are very low. So just, I think, about 10 games were higher than 30 goals. So I think this is not a good point to compare the same things.
Okay. Talking about stronger than ever, are still everyone with us? Just noticed
yep.
We had some sound problems.
Yes.
Okay.
Let's make it a big long one for the first one back, Thomas. You know, let's just keep going. This is great stuff. You're doing a great job over there. Keep it up.
Stronger than ever. Tom, you mentioned Sigurdsson as like the vital signing for Barcelona. I mean, everyone ahead of last season, everyone had Barcelona on their notepads. Everyone said they literally probably go through the season undefeated, and in the end, they only came third. Tom and Goran, I throw this question to you, but what can we expect of Barcelona this season?
I think exactly the same as we expect as last season. I think that they showed against Rhein-Neckar-Löwen that when the chips were down, they were able to do it. And in the final four, I said it in my blog when I wrote it after the thing, SG stands for six goals, if everybody remembers. And I said, if you played that game another 99 times, Barcelona would win it, because it was just one of those bizarre happenings. That's not to take away from Flensburg what they achieved that day, but this Barcelona team, Thomas, is absolutely sensational. And if Saric, who we know can be an absolutely brilliant goalkeeper, is on his game, they are one of the favourites again. And I think that Sigurdsson is going to complement Victor Tomás. I think that we still have to write them down as one of the teams that will go to the final four.
Yeah. Goran, are they kind of top of your favourites list as well?
Yes, also like last season. If you saw the Barcelona on the Super Globe tournament in Qatar, you will see that is the same team from last year. It was stronger. That's my opinion. So even before the start of this Champions League, I will also bet on Barcelona that will be on the final four. But every time the surprises are here, this year maybe could be also some surprises on the final four, like Flensburg. But for me, Barcelona is always the favorite team, also one of the top four teams who will be in Cologne. So I will also bet for Barcelona without any doubts.
Thomas, something occurred to me there about the Philippe Gardon question about coaching.
Yeah.
And the fact is that I spoke to a lot of the coaches before the season start. Manolo Cadena said, you know, when you sign that many new players, it brings some problems, but the other thing is it gives you this big boost, you know, because everything's new and so on and so forth, right? I spoke with Xavi Pascual, and he said to me, look, Tom, we're working. It's going to take a little bit of time to kind of get over what happened last season, but we're working on pace. Now, I saw a little bit of the just some highlights from Doha, but the fact of the matter is, whatever the coaches are doing now is basically what they will have done for the whole season. And this brings me back to Gardon. It's about keeping people happy, about keeping them fit, because all the top teams are going to be playing games every 3 days with traveling and so on and so forth. I would imagine there's very few actual training days where you get the team and you say, okay, we're going to do this. Maybe the night before a big game in the Champions League, you might be able to work one movement or whatever else like that. Bjorn would know better. He's in touch with all the German teams. But with the Seha League now, West Brom is in there. The Asabal League, of course, and the Champions League, teams are playing matches every 3 days. And if you take traveling into consideration, there's not an awful lot of time where the coach can actually train the team, where he actually does something where he goes, right, we're going to work on this move or this concept or this defense.
Yeah. Well, guys, it's time to, you know, put your hat on the chopping block, I think, as they say. Time to give me some names for the final four, the four teams that you think will be there, and of course the one team that wins. Before we start, John Ryan, who many of you will remember was part of our first Hangout and had all four teams correct that time, he sent us his predictions, and just to give you some hints, so he thinks that Rhein-Neckar-Löwen, Paris, Barcelona and Kiel will be the four teams to be in Cologne, with Paris actually winning it. And just to give you one more, Jorge Daguel, an esteemed journalist from Spain, he said that Barca, Kiel, West Brom and Rhein-Neckar-Löwen are going to be the four teams in Cologne. Well, I know that Tom always wants to be last, so Björn, you're happy to be first?
Okay, no problem. So, my prediction is Kielce, West Brom and Kiel, and then I would say a mixture of Barcelona, or pick Chaget. Nobody mentioned pick Chaget, and they really got a strong team. So I would say in the end, okay, Kielce, West Brom, Kiel, and Barcelona.
Okay, and who wins?
That team which is ahead after the final. I would say, okay, this year, maybe Barcelona can avoid facing a German team in the semi-final, and if they avoid a German team in the semi-final, they go to the final, and then they might win it. Barcelona.
Barcelona, okay. Goran.
I have one surprise. The winner will be Kielce.
Okay.
For the final four will be Kielce, Kiel, West Brom, Barcelona, and maybe one team from Skopje. That means five, but I think could be another surprise. For me, surprise is Kielce will be the winner, and the second surprise will be the team from Skopje in Cologne.
Okay, I think Talent will be delighted to hear what you just said. Katarina, what are your predictions for the Final Four?
Oh, well, I think Björn's right with West Brom. I think Barca is either there, and then, well, there are so many teams, so I just have two choices, and I picked THW Kiel because I think they have a good team, and they will do it. And hopefully, I hope Ljubo will do it again and will join the EHF Final Four. I wished it for him, so hopefully it will happen. But who is able to win? No idea. From now on, I would say West Brom, because I think they have a strong team and a good mind and some interesting players. And meanwhile, thinking on the THW back years ago, you will find it now in West Brom. So I think West Brom will do a great job in this season. Hopefully, they won't get some stones on me.
Is there a fourth team missing? I only counted three, or maybe I didn't hear one.
Oh, I said West Brom, Barca, Kiel, and
Kiel. Okay, there you got the four. Okay, well, Tom, before you get entirely holy and no one can recognize you anymore because you're wearing glasses and mustaches, go ahead.
I don't want any. This is not Tom anymore. I'm going to put my thinking cap on, Thomas. Okay. And no, I basically, I was messing around. Google is great, isn't it? It's got all these little things going on. All right, there we go. No, I was going to do it in disguise, Thomas, but I'm going to do it as the real me. And I'm going to base it on the transfers. And I'm going to give you the list based on the best transfers of the season for me in terms of the teams that have strengthened the best. And let's review it in about seven rounds time, shall we?
Yeah.
So I'm going to go PSG, West Brom, Kiel, and Barcelona will make it to the Final Four. Just based on business over the summer.
And who wins it?
And based on that, I will say if Duvniak can play in a system that Gislason likes, I will say Kiel will win it.
Okay. Well, four different winners, exactly. And if we add John Ryan to the list, then we even have five different winners. Well, as Tom said, I think there's going to be a chance to review it, maybe not to change it, but to have a look again. And guys, I thank you very much for joining us tonight. Thank you all for your predictions, for your analysis. Thanks for the applause. Have a good night, and we'll see you again soon for the next Hangout. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.